Peace of the risen Lord be among us this morning. And also with you. It's good to be in God's presence and simply to acknowledge that this hour is not like any other hour we will spend this week. For this hour, we are invited to hear God's word, to know his presence, to lift our eyes, our hearts, our minds, our bodies, to worship him and to refocus everything on the one who made us and loved us. So we're going to sing together, glory, glory in the highest and only a holy God.
Glory in the highest, glory.
a world where there is turmoil and riot, where there is disconnect and conflict out there and sometimes in here, we come before the Lord. Scripture says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is all I need. Therefore, I will wait on him. The Lord is good to those who hope in him, the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Let's pray. Holy God, we come before you. We lift our eyes, our souls, our hearts from the things around us that trouble us to you who comforts us. We look today, this morning, for your salvation, for your healing, for your forgiveness, and for your peace. We worship you for your love that is new every morning, your love that is shown and given to us in Jesus Christ. And as we gather in this place, we ask by your Holy Spirit that our spirits would be made holy, renewed, restored, lifted, that we may worship you in the name of Jesus, in whom we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Did you see the flowers? Agnes did these, I think. Did she this week? Thank you, Agnes. We just thank Agnes. You know, one of the things that we sometimes don't do is say thank you. And I was thinking this morning about all the things that we don't notice that go into getting our service ready for today. And I'm going to forget some of them, so you'll need to remind me. I was going to say thank you to our cleaners who cleaned the place for us this morning. Yeah? Thank you. And thank you to... Who else has done things? Thank you to Eric, who's got all the music ready and the choir for rehearsing this morning. Thank you to Ian Matthew, who's going to be doing a marathon reading for us later on. Thank you to the folk that welcomed us, opened the doors up and welcomed us this morning. Will we thank them? Yeah? Anyone I've forgotten? Anyone else we should thank this morning? The folk that are going to do tea and coffee afterwards, after the service. Yeah? Thank you. Come and prepared that for us. Yeah? Sorry? Thank the minister. Why would you want to do that? I've had COVID this week, so I'm actually quite thankful I'm able to be here this morning. Yeah, thank you to all of you. Many folk this morning will have struggled to get here. Maybe you struggled to get up out of bed. For young folk, that's difficult. Or you struggled to get somebody else out of bed. Or just this morning was difficult. So thank you for coming, because that encourages folk. We thank folk for coming. Yeah? You know, there is so much that we sometimes forget to be thankful for folk that do the gardens, for folk that look after the property, for folk that look after the money in the church, for the folk that give the money that lets the church keep going, for the folk that are preparing for guild, preparing for youth organizations to go back. There is so much in our church to give thankful for, the folk that are going to be doing something with children during the service this morning. So, and all the people I've forgotten, because somebody's sitting there saying, you didn't thank me. So can we just thank everybody? And I would just encourage you not just to clap a little bit just now, but actually when you see folk and interact with people, think about how you encourage those that do things week by week. Encourage one another to come. I was just reading this week where it says this. This is what Paul writes. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with wisdom and psalms and hymns and songs from the spirits, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it in the name of Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. It says there three times, be thankful or do it with gratitude. And that's something that we sometimes forget about. Not just giving thanks to each other, but giving thanks to God for all the things that he has given us. And I wonder that we might just share that with each other just for a minute or two. We're quite good sometimes at sharing our pains and the things that are difficult in life, and it's good to do that. But sometimes we're slow in sharing the things that we're thankful for. It could be deep things, or it could just be the sun is shining this morning. So I wonder if you just turn to the folk around you, make sure no one's excluded, and just share some things that make you thankful as you come to praise this morning. Let's do that just now. What are you thankful for? I'm thankful to hear so many folks sharing and talking this morning. It's good that it's not all my words, but actually all our thankfulness that we bring before God. Being thankful isn't just something we do to please God, like writing a thank you letter to an auntie who's given us a gift. It's something we do because it changes our own hearts to appreciate what we've got, and to be a people who are always rejoicing, even when things are tough and difficult. And that's really, really important. So I wonder this morning, we've given claps to each other and encouraged one another, but we might just together lift our hearts and say thank you to the Lord. So we're going to say thank you out loud for all the things we've spoken of, and then give a round of applause in our thankfulness to God for all he's given us. One, two, three, thank you. We're going to sing a hymn of praise, asking that God would glorify his name in us. And Eric's going to tell us how we're going to do this, because we're going to do it as a round. Thank you, Eric.
So here's how we'll do it. The choir will sing, Father, we adore you. This side, along with the transept, will sing, Jesus, we adore you. And this side of the church will sing, Spirit. So it's not really confusing. It's just the first word that's different. So three verses as normal, and then Father, Jesus, Spirit. Happy confusion.
We're very grateful to those that have arranged activities over the summer for children, and this is the last week of that, because next week we have an all-age service, and the following week junior church and creche are back as usual. Next week is a special week because we also have three folk joining the church, and we're delighted with that. And Nicola Hume and Elaine Stewart and Alison MacDonald are going to be professing their faith as part of that service, an all-age service, and becoming part of our congregation here. So please pray for them as we look forward to that. The only other announcement I've got is that a week on Saturday, GLOW is celebrating its 50th anniversary, which, and incidentally, is part of the history of this church, because it's 50 years ago that that building ceased to be part of the union here, and that the building became part of GLOW. So we're marking that. And they're having an open day on that Saturday, and they've invited us all to go along, but they've also invited us to do a table with some activities, craft activities for young folk. And I think we've got an idea to do that, but we're looking for a few folk just to come for an hour or two and man that stall, or shouldn't say man, should I, people that stall. So if you're available a week on Saturday, if you can speak to myself or to Elaine, then we'll get a few folk to come along and we'll do some activities with young people. But do remember to come and share with that over that period. There's some posters we'll put up, and I'll put it in the sheet next week. So thank you for that. Now let's come to God's Word, and Ian's going to come and read to us from the book of 1 Samuel. Let's hear the Word of God.
Morning's from 1 Samuel chapter 18, and it's titled Saul's Growing Fear of David. After David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. From that day, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return home to his family. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan took off the robe he was wearing and gave it to David, along with his tunic and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. Whatever mission Saul sent him on, David was so successful that Saul gave him a high mark rank in the army. This pleased all the troop and Saul's officers as well. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joyful songs and with timbrels and lyres. As they danced, they sang, "Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands." Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. "They have credited David with tens of thousands," he thought, "but me with only thousands. What more can he get but the kingdom?" And from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. The next day, an evil spirit from God came forcibly on Saul. He was prophesying in his house while David was playing the lyre, as he usually did. Saul had a spear in his hand and he hurled it, saying to himself, "I'll pin David to the wall," but David eluded him twice. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David, but had departed from Saul. So he sent David away from him, and he gave him command over 1,000 men, and David led the troops in their campaigns. In everything he did, he had great success because the Lord was with him. When Saul saw how successful he was afraid of him, but all Israel and Judah loved David because he led them in their campaigns. Saul said to David, "Here is my oldest daughter, Merab. I will give her to you in marriage. Only serve me bravely and fight the battles of the Lord." For Saul said to himself, "I will not raise a hand against him. Let the Philistines do that." But David said to Saul, "Who am I? And what is my family or my clan in Israel that I should become the king's son-in-law?" So when the time came for Merab, Saul's daughter, to be given to David, she was given in marriage to Adriel of Meholah. Now Saul's daughter, Michal, was in love with David, and when he told Saul about it, he was pleased. "I will give her to him," he thought, "so that she may be a snare to him, and so that the hand of the Philistines may be against him." So Saul said to David, "Now you have a second opportunity to become my son-in-law." Then Saul ordered his attendants, "Speak to David privately and say, 'Look, the king likes you, and his attendants all love you. Now become his son-in-law.'" They repeated these words to David, but David said, "Do you think it's a small matter to become the king's son-in-law? I am only a poor man and little known." When Saul's servants told him what David had said, Saul replied, "Say to David, 'The king wants no other price for the bride than 100 Philistine foreskins. Take revenge on his enemies.'" Saul's plan was to have David fall by the hands of the Philistines. When the attendants told David these things, he was pleased to become the king's son-in-law. So therefore, before the allotted time elapsed, David took his men with him and went out and killed 200 Philistines and brought back their foreskins. They counted out the full number to the king so that David might become the king's son-in-law. Then Saul gave him his daughter Michal in marriage. When Saul realized that the Lord was with David and that his daughter Michal loved David, Saul became still more afraid of him, and he remained his enemy the rest of his days. The Philistine commanders continued to go out to battle, and as often as they did, David met with more success than the rest of Saul's officers, and his name became well known. Amen.
Thanks, Ian, for reading that. It's one of these stories from 1 Samuel. They are terrific stories, and they're not necessarily stories we're as familiar with as we might be, but we can learn so much from them. So let's pray. Father, we pray as we come to your word from so long ago that today it might speak to us. It might speak to our souls and how we live in this day. Amen. In the film Amadeus, Salieri, the court musician in Vienna, starts as a very devout man. And in fact, he makes a prayer that says, God, let me bring music that will glorify you, and through my music, let me move the heart of the people to heaven. But if you've seen the film, you'll know a little bit about the story, because what happens is he meets a young man called Mozart, who's actually a young boy at the time. And despite the fact that Mozart is immature and quite obscene in his talking, there's something about his music that is just amazing. And Salieri gets enraged because God has given Mozart all this gifting that he wanted for himself, and he's envious, and so he vows that he's going to destroy Mozart. And the story descends from there to envy and eventually to murder. When we turn to the story that we've just read of Saul, it's not that different. Saul is the king. So we've been following the story. He's appointed by God when the people ask for a king. And really the king has got two purposes. He's to lead God's people and to help them as they follow God. And secondly, to win them victory over their enemies, the Philistines. Now, as we've seen as we've gone through this book, Saul completely fails at the first of those. He becomes, instead of someone that should lead the people towards God, someone who is more obsessed with himself. He's building statues to himself. He's taking the positions that he shouldn't be taking. But he's fairly good at the second. He's a good commander in battle, and he wins many victories. And then in the chapter before the one we read, Saul loses his nerve. He takes his army out, and they're on one hill, and the Philistines are on the other, and Saul loses his nerve, and he will not engage in battle. He will not trust God to give him the victory. And eventually what happens, and you know the story, is a young boy comes forward and says, I'll go and fight that big Philistine for you. And Saul actually has the grace to see that there's something of God in this. And so he allows David to go forward, fight Goliath, and the rest, as they say, is history. David, at the start, seemed to give Saul what he needed. And Saul realized David's value. He keeps him close by. He makes him a general. Saul is getting old now, and he needs good fighting generals on the front line, so he makes David a general. And together they're successful, king and general, winning battles and fulfilling God's purpose. And the army's approving, and the people are approving, and the servants of Saul, the civil service, if you like, of the royal court, are approving. And the women, well, they're approving too. I guess this young lad, David, is a sort of, I don't know, a young Daniel Craig or something like that. He's good looking, and he's the up and coming man. Everybody's happy. But the tragedy of the story that Ian read is envy creeps in. Now, we know, because Scripture tells us, that we shouldn't covet. And coveting is bad because it's looking at somebody else and saying, I want your stuff. I want your iPhone. I want your car. I want to have things like that too. But this is worse, because envy isn't just wanting someone's stuff. It's looking at someone's life and saying, I want your life. That's what I want. I want to be you. Now, if we can think about it in very contemporary terms, and it's perhaps not a bad week to think about this, about exam results. A young person gets exam results. Many of folk in our own families did this week as the SQA results came out. Have I got that right? Yeah. And perhaps a young person gets exam results, and they're not bad. They feel quite happy about that, and their family are telling them that they've worked hard and they've done that. And then they see that their friend has got better results. And instead of sharing the joy of their friend, out comes the envy monster. And it destroys their contentment. It destroys the joy that they might have taken in their friend's success. I do wonder, as people post things on social media about how wonderful their kids have done, what the impact is of that on other people. Saul was the older man. He was the king, and he'd fought Philistines his whole life. He'd beaten them many times. And he could have said, well, you know, beating Philistines is a good thing to do. It's what God needs for his people right now. And here's this young general being really successful. I am really proud of him, and I'm blessed that God has enabled me to be his mentor, to give him the opportunity to bring him into this place. And I celebrate this desire that I have to see this mission against the Philistines accomplished, and it now being done through David. And isn't the kingdom safer because General David? But rather than that joy, envy took it all away. I mean, have you think of contemporary times where a leader has mentored another leader, and then as that other leader has soared, the first leader has become quite antagonistic? Doesn't happen in Scotland, does it? Sir John Gielgud said with honesty, when Laurence Olivier played Hamlet, the critics raved, and I wept. Or a quote that I really like from Gore Vidal, which says, every time a friend succeeds, I die a little. It's the honesty about envy. And Saul moves from valuing David and giving him opportunities and promoting him in a way that's advantageous to David and to Saul and to the common interest of God's people, to playing a zero-sum game of rivalry. Verse 9 says, he eyed David. You can see it, can't you? The paranoia, the comparison, the insecurity of the leader. How do we apply that? Well, I wonder, we can make it very contemporary. Can you think today of a leader on the public stage who's insecure, who lashes out at his opponents from that place of insecurity, who thinks he's God's man, and all the rest of it? Well, it's pretty easy, isn't it, as you look at the American election cycles, to see that. You can imagine Donald Trump looking out at his opponents. But of course, the problem with Donald Trump when you're doing sermons is it's too easy a candidate, isn't it? Because we look at Donald Trump and we think, well, the minister can criticize him. I'm not like Donald Trump. Anyone think they're like Donald Trump? Your hair's better. Or are we a bit like Donald Trump? Do you know what it is to feel someone else's success make you feel insecure? Do you know what it is to see the limelight on someone else and to think, what about me? Maybe you're a parent and other people are talking about their child's success. They're playing piano age 3. They're doing calculus age 7. Whatever it is that their child is doing that's amazing. And rather than anything else, rather than celebrating, you begin to feel your own inadequacy. Or maybe it's as a Christian. You come to a church where somebody's sharing something about what God has done in their life. Instead of praising God for what he's done in their life or their ministry or whatever else it is, you're left feeling inadequate. God doesn't use me like that. That's discouraging. And we're back to Saul. eyeing David, the green-eyed monster that he has become. And it says in verse 10 that an evil spirit from God comes. Now, one of those passages in the Bible that's quite difficult to understand, and I'll be honest enough to say I don't really understand how God sends an evil spirit, but let me have a little go at what that might mean, and I just put might. When the Holy Spirit comes upon us, God sends the Holy Spirit to equip us for tasks, but also to convict us of what we are doing wrong, that we might repent and we might receive the fruit of the Spirit that make us gracious and kind and loving and good. But what happens if we become aware of the Spirit and we feel the conviction of the Spirit, and instead of repenting, we resist? Saul starts off by getting David to come and play hymns to him on his harp or whatever it is. But as he's convicted of his envy by the Spirit of God in David's godly presence, a rage comes. He's not willing to repent. He's going to resist, and only evil can come of that. If you feel convicted, there is a need to come in repentance, that may move your maturity. But Saul does the opposite. He becomes broody and resentful, because envy is destructive. It is self-destructive. And he begins by cutting off his nose to spite his face. He's got this young general that can give him success, but he's going to try to undo it. First of all, he removes David from his presence, which is crazy because David was a source of healing to him in his playing for him, but he doesn't want that help. And the removal's a failure because David just becomes even more successful as a general. And Saul falls in awe of him. And so he tries to destroy him by promoting him. He offers him a daughter, then another daughter, so that David will fight harder and he will die. He just wants David's defeat. Imagine that. He's suddenly wanting his armies to lose and his generals to be defeated, all because of envy. You see, envy moves from "I want to be you" to "I want to destroy you." Now, we maybe think, well, that's not us. We don't want to kill people. But how quickly does envy move from not being pleased about what someone is achieving and not finding joy in it to actually wanting to tear them down, to find fault, to show that they're not all they're cracked up to be, to dismiss their achievements? And sometimes it's in simple ways. Somebody will have a sporting achievement, and what we'll want to say is, well, sport isn't that important after all, is it? Or somebody will have a musical achievement, much different. Well, let's change and talk about something I'm good at. Or somebody has an academic achievement and we want to say there's more to life than exam results. If we don't say it, it's in our hearts, because what we're wanting to do is to change the rules so that somehow that person isn't so full of themselves. That's the envy again. It's the story I'd heard of where the person rubs the lamp and the genie comes out, and the genie says to the man, "I'll do whatever you want for you." And the man says, "What's the catch?" He says, "Well, here's the catch. Whatever I do for you or give to you, I'm going to give your rival twice that." The man thinks for a minute and says, "Okay, scare me half to death." Envy. It can happen in the church, actually. You see, rather than focus on a common task that we all have together as Christians to build the kingdom of God and see people come to faith, we end up being about denominational rivalries. I want the Church of Scotland to do better than the Baptists. I want my church to do better than the one down the road. That's what envy does. We begin to look at the Facebook posts of another congregation, and instead of saying it's fantastic, the mission work they're doing, we end up saying, "Oh, we should be having stuff like that." Envy that creeps in. And envy begins with entitlement. "He doesn't deserve that. I do. I should have that adulation. I should have that success." Here's Saul saying, "I'm the king. He's only a shepherd boy. I made him. I promoted him. I made him the vice president. You know, whatever else it is. Of course, the irony is that Saul started as a donkey farmer and all the kingdom was God's gift to him. That's the problem with envy. We forget that what we have is also a gift. And the antidote to that is thankfulness, isn't it? The humility of being thankful for what God has given us. We see it in David, where despite all his success, he's able to say, yeah, I want to do well on the battlefield. Yeah, I want to work my hardest. But along comes the opportunity to marry the king's daughter, and David responds by saying, actually, I'm not worthy. Because he's not somebody who's interested only in promoting himself. His eyes on the cause, on the victory of the people. And that means that he's ambitious in one sense to give his best to get to where he can, to serve God as he can, but he's not personally ambitious that says, actually, the aim is to get me to the top of the tree. We can be successful without being personally ambitious that plays the rat race game. What's the antidote to this? What's the good news here? Well, the good news in this story is right at the start, because we're introduced to David not in his rivalry with Saul, but in his friendship with Jonathan. Now, this is actually quite remarkable if you think about it, because David and Jonathan are bound together as soulmates, we're told here. Some folk have read this passage actually and suggested that there was something between David and Jonathan that was of a homosexual nature. That's been discussed many times. My response to that would be, why, when we see a friendship, do we have to assume that it's sexual? There's nothing in Scripture that implies that. Who is Jonathan? Well, he's older than David. He's about 20 years older, probably. And he is the eldest son of Saul. He is the crown prince. Now, think about the implications of that for a moment. Because if Saul saw David as the coming man and a potential threat, then Jonathan should have seen him as a bigger threat. Jonathan should be the next king, and yet God is lining up David to be the next king. And yet we find in Jonathan no defensiveness. In fact, he's giving gifts to David. He's giving him armor and sword, a bow and a belt. Jonathan is a warrior, but he recognizes that David is more gifted. And that's great. Can I equip him? Can I give him things that he can be even better, that he can fly ahead? That's what friendship should do, isn't it? I want my friend to succeed, even succeed beyond me. And he delights in his success. In fact, he gives them his robe, which is a sign of royal status. If God wanted David to be the leader, Jonathan is happy to get out of the way. We see a little bit of that in John the Baptist, in the New Testament, where people come to John the Baptist and John says, I must decrease that he might increase. And that's what I'm about. I'm not about being the top dog. I'm about enabling and equipping others to fly and achieve their potential. Jonathan isn't threatened, doesn't hold on to his status. He sees that what's important is the victory of the people. And if David can achieve that more than he can, that's fine with him. The important thing is to realize that which God is calling us to do is more important than our recognition. That's true humility. To share in the joy of the success of others and of the group. This is really important in practical ways. My job is not to be the best minister I can be. Because if I do that, I will go and compare myself to others. My job is to desire the kingdom of God to be built. And that's what we should be about. Our task, by the way, as a church, as we look at what we're doing, isn't to build DL St. Andrews to be the best church in the area and the strongest church and have the most members. It's rather to see the kingdom of God built in Scotland, in the world, and in Motherwell. And it doesn't really matter what the church structures are. That's not important. We can rejoice in success elsewhere. We can spend ourselves in equipping mission in other places. It doesn't matter. We're not in competition. And that's what real love is, and focus on God's purpose. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. We need to ask God to give us grace in our relationships. And if we have grace in our relationships, we don't resent it when someone else gets forgiven for something that we never got away with. Remember that from your childhood when a sibling got away with something that you'd have got shouted at for? And we felt resentment. We should not feel resentment when someone else is forgiven. We should not be resentful when people are behaving in ways that we were not free to behave. We should not be resentful when other people have more knowledge than us. That often leaves us feeling small. We should not be resentful when other people are being loved and cared for, and we shouldn't have that feeling, well, I don't get treated like that. We should rather rejoice in the love and the care that someone else is experiencing. All sorts of problems stem from envy. It happens in churches, by the way. What does the church focus on? And one of the problems when we try to focus on any particular group as a church is that somebody else says, well, what about me? So if we focus on the young folk, we have older folk saying, oh, we should be focusing on older folk. You know, and vice versa. When people are asked to do something, envy can creep in as well. Somebody's asked to do something up front or whatever else it is, and you think, nobody ever asked me. Who does he think he is? And we want to pull them down. Or it can show its way as somebody else begins to share something. Have you been there? And the temptation is to say, what about me? What about me? Let's talk about me. And suddenly we are channeling our inner Donald Trump, showing our insecurity. But if we recognize that what we have is a gift, and others have gifts too, we seek the benefit and the blessing of all as the kingdom grows. Now, Jonathan, in one sense, in this passage, is a little bit of a messianic figure. What does he do? He literally dethrones himself and raises up someone who will actually take his own position. He allows himself to play a vital role in God's plan, not by being the king, but by letting David fly. That really is the heart of the gospel. Because in one sense, Jesus is our Jonathan. He takes on the servant's part despite being the rightful king, that we might be blessed. He lowers himself that we might be lifted up. He takes the blame in order that we might be forgiven. Something that we could never have deserved is given to us because of Jesus. And when we fully understand that, we don't just see Jesus as a role model, but we have that ultimate security that we are loved, that we are held, that we are forgiven, that we have been given everything that we didn't deserve because of Jesus. And that means that life becomes not holding on, not worrying about our place in the pecking order, not feeling resentment because we feel that we're being made the lowest, but being secure enough in God's love for us that we, like Jesus, are willing to give up honor, status, position. So I leave you just with a question. What is precious to you? What are you oversensitive about? What is making you insecure? And can you lay it down into God's love for you and know that your importance is not in that, but in the one who gave himself for you? We're going to sing "The Lord's My Shepherd." And that's not just to sing the next hymn. It is to reflect on the words attributed to David from Psalm 23, of knowing that we are led by still waters, that we are held as we go through, because it is in that security that we turn from our own insecurities and comparison and simply know God's love. Let's sing these words. This week, in how God's word isn't just about learning things, God's law isn't just about obeying things, it's actually about food for our souls and our contentment. One might sum up what I preached on with the last of the Ten Commandments: thou shalt not covet. There it is. And again, we can see those commandments as instructions but I would just invite us to see them in a different way of stilling our souls and knowing this is God saying to us, this is what is good for you. Do not covet, but be thankful and content with what I have given you and how I have gifted you. If you are, and I confess not always to be taking the time I should just to meditate on scripture. Just this week I've re-picked up on my app, my phone, if you've got a phone or a tablet, at Lectio 365. Look for the app. It gives a meditation for the morning or the evening. You can either just read it or it will play it to you quite quietly. It's for about 7 or 8 minutes. And it just helps you reflect. So have a look for that, Lectio 365. I'll put it on the announcement sheet for next week, just if you've not got something that you're using. Because it really isn't about teaching or learning. It's just about meditating before God's word. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we are more competitive than we know. For some of us, it pushes us on. For others, it crushes us. For we often feel insecure and inadequate. Teach us to be content and to be thankful. For all we have is a gift, and for all others have is a gift, that the body of Christ may be built up. We thank you that you have given us already that which we do not deserve, that we need no praise from other people, for you have called us your daughters and your sons, and we rejoice in that. Help us to rest in you, to keep this Sabbath holy by spending time with you and not to covet. And as we come before you just now, we pray for things that are bigger than us, Lord. We turn our hearts to the world around us, a world that can seem riotous and confusing, and we pray, Lord, for peace, for hearts of people who feel discontented to be made contented, for hearts of people who feel angry and blaming of other communities to rather be turned to wanting to bless them. We pray, Lord, against forces of racism, hatred and discontent. We pray for the wisdom of leaders, both those that make the decisions on policing and justice, but also those that give a lead in what they say and in how they influence, that they may be turning to do that for the greatest good and the protection of the most vulnerable. We pray, Lord, for those places in this world where conflict remains, thinking of Palestine and Israel, of Russia and Ukraine, issues that are so big for us but not for you. And we commit them to you and we pray for peace, justice, and healing. And in this week, we would also pray for our schools, for our young people as they return to lessons, for our teachers, for that place where so much is influenced and shaped, that their too goodness and mercy and healing may be. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Good to sing in closing an old hymn, Come Down, O Love Divine. These words can be words that we sing out of familiarity if we know them, or if we don't know them, they're quite difficult words in some ways. But this is a prayer that the Holy Spirit would come upon us, into our hearts, and change them and heal them. Oh, come down, O love divine, that's the Holy Spirit, and fill us. Burn up all that is wrong in us, that our earthly passions go to dust and ashes, as the second verse says, and might be clothed and cleaned in your light, and so that we might have a yearning strong that would be for God himself, and the Holy Spirit might live within us. So even if the words are difficult, let them float in us as we ask for God's Holy Spirit to fill us and that which we've spoken of this morning to be ours as we go out from this place. So let's close as we sing this prayer together. Go in the blessing of the Father, in the blessing of the Son, and may the Holy Spirit fill you this day and forevermore.